At this point, what I'd like to do is open the discussion to a couple of the other people on the panel. And if I may, I'm going to start with Rick Davis. So, Rick, perhaps you'd like to introduce yourself very briefly and then get to your questions. I do warn everybody that sometime in about the next 15 minutes, I'm going to want to open this up to the rest of the audience for their questions as well. So if you could try and keep your questions brief, that would be helpful. Rick?
Hi. Yeah. Hello, Mike. Hello, Dr. Hussain and Tony and Jan, the rest of the panel. I am an advocate, and my particular interest is helping men with advanced disease and their caregivers. I've worked with Mike and with some of the people on the panel for quite a while. Let me get straight to the question. You earlier on, Dr. Hussain, referenced the ipilimumab and PROSVAC study, which had some pretty remarkable results, albeit early. I'd like you, if you would, to expand on your thoughts on the role of immunotherapy in prostate cancer treatment. And in particular, I am aware from working with two or three patients who are treated at your center that your institution doesn't favor Sipuleucel-T or Provenge, and I'm wondering how that works into your thoughts on immunotherapy.
Sure. So thank you very much, Rick. I'm going to begin by first of all saying that we are, as a physician and as a researcher and as a doctor with a lot of patients, my obligations are to my patients. And I do think that, and I would like to also highlight that I do believe that the immune system does have a potential role. It is yet to be proven in the context of the types of drugs we're talking about right now. So I'm not making a comment about Sipuleucel, but rather the GVAX and so on. I think the data looks very promising, and I will tell you this as I tell people too. I am old enough to have seen very promising things sink or be even harmful. I'm sorry, I said GVAX, I meant PROSVAC. So I would say I think the immune system is something that we need to harness. I think that it's not simple and it's very complicated. I also know that I deal with other cancers myself, specifically bladder cancer, and I certainly look at the literature in lung and renal cell and so on, there is no question that there are some tumors that are much more prone to immune system manipulation in terms of treatment as opposed to others. And so, again, I think there is promise. I think it's important to support these types of trials to see what it would, you know, what would the final results be. And I would encourage patients to consider being part of these trials as much as possible. I also keep an open mind about their value, but I fully agree with you, and that's why I actually listed earlier on that particular trial out of the GU ASCO as a very interesting and promising type approach. The Sipuleucel situation, we actually, there's a group of us, we are six medical oncologists who deal with prostate cancer. And when the Sipuleucel came to the market, it was very clear that an infrastructure was necessary because, as you know, it's not just a pharmacy-prescribed agent. You'd have to get the patient sample sent and so on. And so an infrastructure was necessary to be developed and built. And we have in the area multiple centers who have actually been participants in the Sipuleucel trials and therefore had a priori established infrastructure. So we actually did sort of querying our patients to see what the take rate is with our patients. And surprisingly, the take rate was not huge. And I will say that till today, I have referred maybe two or three patients, and this is probably about the average for our group. So it's not believing. It's more after discussions with our patients with regard to what's available in terms of options and what can be done and so on. And if a patient seeks or is interested, we make a point of referring them to a center locally, whether it's Detroit or in the region, where they could get the cyclosporine treatments. I don't know if that answers your question.
Yes, thank you.
And your second question, Rick?
My second question, again, you've sort of touched on this, but the recent research from the Prostate Cancer Dream Team West and some other places suggests that around maybe 30% of advanced prostate cancer morphs from being a sort of adenocarcinoma, hormone-sensitive cancer, to a form that much more acts and resembles and responds like small cell neuroendocrine disease. Now, right now, those folks are oftentimes being treated with carboplatin together with docetaxel or taxotere, or sometimes cabazitaxel or gefitinib. I am wondering how you see this morph disease being treated in the future, and what other treatments are currently currently in trial that might become available to help this significant section of men that seem to have this strange form of prostate cancer.
This is an excellent question, Rick, and I would say there are varying opinions on these observations. So we have actually, let me begin by saying that adenocarcinoma can have what we call neuroendocrine differentiation, but it's still a prostate cancer adenocarcinoma. So cancers sometimes acquire features that are not necessarily going to impact on their response to conventional treatment. And the only thing I want to clarify, that an adenocarcinoma does not have to be hormone responsive or hormone sensitive, because your average prostate cancer that we treat, when it metastasizes, it is still an adenocarcinoma. It's just hormone resistant because it develops resistant mechanisms, and it's not necessarily neuroendocrine nor small cell. The other distinction I want to make is that it is only for the small cell of small cell carcinoma. So this is basically, these are small round cells, and that's why they call them small cell. They have no specific glandular differentiation and have certain features that are very characteristic to that cell type, which, by the way, most common area for it is in the lung cancer. We see it with other diseases like bladder and so on. That when the cells end up to become that way, it's generally the very minority of times. It's not a 30%. It's an extreme, I'd say, few percentages. And those are the patients we generally treat like we treat the sort of the lung cancer, with a platinum plus etoposide type thing or taxane. The difficulty, I think, that we're having to deal with is exactly in the category of non-small cell, but an adenocarcinoma that has a significant neuroendocrine features to it. And in that regard, I'm not sure that we have enough data that says these are the patients that should be treated differently than what you normally treat. I should point out also that we do have also a Stand Up to Cancer East Coast Dream Team, which Michigan is the lead institution, and I do not believe we've seen that high rate of histology. And in part, I wonder if it's because of the sample of the patients you're referring to are patients who have already been through two layers of hormonal agents, I believe, abiraterone and enzalutamide. Mm-hmm. So I do think that it's a very interesting observation For the small cell, there's no question we use a different type of chemo, and hormones are not the way to go, nor is the average prostate cancer chemotherapy. I would say for anything less than that, I cannot tell you that I am convinced that I have seen any data that says they should be treated any differently right now. Now, there are agents that are being evaluated for neuroendocrine type tumors, and I believe there was one trial that was being planned or is ongoing right now. But short of that, I am not aware of any trials in prostate cancer for this particular histology or differentiation.
So just a quick follow-up, what hope can you give to men that are faced with, who are not responding to abiraterone, not responding to enzalutamide? What is in the pipeline for those men?
Oh, so I would say several things, and let me begin by pointing out that clearly not responding to abiraterone and enzalutamide does not take hope away, in that you have actually cabazitaxel and docetaxel as very active agents in prostate cancer. By no means a cure, but certainly they can work in these settings. They also have radium, Zofigo, radium 223, particularly if the bulk of their cancer is predominantly in the bone. So there's no question that there are treatment choices that are standard of care, and that just because a cancer is not responding to Abi or Enza, that's not the end of the end of hope. There is plenty of other drugs, and we've seen these drugs work for these patients. There are different clinical trials that are being planned or are in the process of being activated, some of them looking at more novel agents, specifically, as I mentioned, androgen signaling type drugs. Some are looking at other relevant pathways so one thing I should say, prostate cancer is a very smart cancer. And the more you squeeze it, the more it develops resistance and begins to adapt. And so there are different drugs targeting certain pathways, like the P10, the PI3 kinase pathway, the CDK4/6, which is cell cycle regulation, and so on. And a lot of combination-type trials are being planned. So I would say there is plenty of trials going. This has been an unprecedented era when it comes to clinical research and clinical trials in prostate cancer. And that's why I think patients should ask their doctors and can actually look around on the clinicaltrials.gov for what might be available. The language is very much lay language, should not be too complicated for the patients, and they should look at that and see if there's something nearby for them, but certainly their doctor should be their resource. Plus, right now, the Internet has all kinds of resources for different cancer centers across the country for the type of trials available.
Thank you, Dr. Hussain. And so with that, we'll move to the patient advocate par excellence, Jan Manarite. Jan, do you have a question for Dr. Hussain?
As you're speaking, Dr. Hussain, I'm thinking a lot about patients who are probably listening, and I like to say that we're in an age of shared decision-making, so we need to share the language and share the information. So there's a few things in the terminology I think I might want to mention that might be helpful. And one is that, and we tell our callers this all the time on the PCRI helpline, is that every drug has two names. So as we're talking about these drugs, we're using the generic name, so it may be a little confusing for them. So abiraterone is the generic for Zytiga. Radium 223 is the generic for Zofigo, and so on. So
and XND for enzalutamide is
right. So just a reminder that every drug has two names to the people listening, and that can help in your research. I also get very excited when I hear you talking about patients making their own treatment decisions or treatment decision with their physician once they understand the risks and understand the benefits, because that's a great way to look at every treatment decision. I often have people make two columns on a piece of paper and write down risk and benefit. But that being said, I do find that patients have to speak up more about the risk column, which is primarily side effects, and that's the place where they can be the most effective in the conversation with the doctor. So I like to encourage them to do that.
And I actually echo your comments 100%.
Yeah.
What we do in general, and that's what I recommend to patients, in 99% of times, the decision doesn't have to happen instantaneously, meaning on the spot. And what I find the most helpful in terms of the shared decision-making is that not to necessarily always make that decision when the patient is sitting with you in the clinic as we talk about things. We try to give them material ahead of time, and there are plenty of resources available for the patients, but we certainly, it's our obligation to provide them what we feel is the most appropriate sort of profile for the agents we're talking about or whether something else we're doing, and that's, I'm talking about standard of care treatments. So that they can actually think about it, look at it. And there are times where patients are eligible for more than one thing. And the question comes up is, what is the preference? And, patients will say, doc, you decide. And I'll say, no, we'll decide together. And so I generally give them the material to think about, to go take it home, reflect on it, talk to their family or spouse or, if they want to. And what I find actually that in literally, I'm going to say 99% of times, maybe, but over 95% of the times, patients will come back and they have a much clearer understanding and much clearer idea of what they really want to do themselves.
Right. And in addition, I sometimes encourage our callers to talk to the nurse about side effects in addition to the doctor. Sometimes that can be very helpful.
Absolutely.
I have one more quick question. One more comment, one more question. I promise I'll be quick. In the clinic, when the patient is talking to the doctor, I think it's helpful for them to know that when the doctor is using the word symptoms or symptomatic, they're probably just referring to pain or most of the time referring to pain. So it's important for men to have discussions about their pain because it can make them eligible or ineligible for certain treatments. So that discussion is really important.
Absolutely. And I would say that I would imagine the vast majority of patients who are now being evaluated, when they enter the clinic, there is a review of systems form that the patients are asked to go through and circle symptoms. This is extremely important to be filled because this is how it will help the physician. Part of my my thing is I look at it, but I go over each one of the things that the patients have circled, because there are times when the doctor walks into the room, all of a sudden the patient forgets lots of things, and the conversation changes, when in reality I think it's very critical to be very, very focused on what is the current symptoms, what are the extent of it, and, what needs to be done to manage the symptoms. And that would hopefully optimize the quality of life.
So perhaps we could have one quick question, Tony. I'm sure you've had plenty of chances to talk to Dr. Hussain before.
I've had chances to do that. Hello, Dr. Maha. It's great to hear you again.
Hi, you.
I had a couple of questions. I'm going to go ahead and just zip right on into it quickly. In doing the patient advocate work over at SWOG, we have a lot of discussion going on about what we're going to be doing with the future. You gave a rousing speech over at ASCO a couple years ago on your 20 years in treating prostate cancer, which I posted on my website. It's absolutely a terrific presentation you did with that. But I want to take it around and look up to the next 20 years. Drug sequencing and translational research, genetic expressions, things like that that we're finding that are exciting on out there right now, on identifying genes in prostate cancer and maybe how it may affect drug sequencing or treatment opportunities into the future.
Tony, this is absolutely on the mark, and I think that I just came in from an international consensus meeting, and I'm going to put it on your radar screen for 2017. It happened in Switzerland, in St. Gallen, which is sort of an area where they used to actually do breast cancer consensus meetings for a long time, and now prostate cancer has also arrived to the scene, where there were international experts with the intent of discussing all of these issues of sort of difficulties in the decision making and the drug sequencing and so on and so forth. But I do think that science is actually teaching us a lot. And let me give you my personal perspective. And it may seem a bit radical, but I do think that it is possible. I actually view that the ultimate benchmark for success is cure. And we know that we've done that with testis cancer. Testis cancer, when it spreads, it is curable. And it's curable not by one drug or two drugs. It's curable by multiple, sort of a multi-drug strategy plus potential for radiation or surgery and so on. So I do think that in prostate cancer, we need to be very mindful of the fact that the tumor sequencing, or as I say, the genetic analysis of the cancer, whether it's the East Coast or the West Coast dream teams that are doing, it's extremely informative with regard to the heterogeneity of this cancer. We have a genetics or a molecular or sequencing tumor board at University of Michigan where our patients who are undergoing a biopsy, the tumor sequenced is presented to look at, you know, what are the mutations and the other molecular alterations and so on. And for some patients, it's amazing how the cancer is complex. And for others, it doesn't have that much, yet it's incredibly resistant. So there's a lot that we don't know, but I do think that there's a lot that we know nowadays. And so if you use my benchmark of saying that the ultimate goal is to cure prostate cancer, and short of cure is to prevent it from becoming castration resistant, since we're talking about metastatic disease, I would say the space where we need to be is really in the hormone-sensitive disease space. This is where we can actually maximize the kill based on what we have today and the fact that the cancer, while it is smart, it is not as smart yet, meaning has not developed resistance mechanisms like more advanced end-stage disease. And I would say that there are the data that we have on, say, the charted trial with the use of docetaxel or Taxotere with hormone treatment is certainly instructive. It's not cure, but certainly the amount of benefit with the combination, which, as you know, this is the trial that was done by ECOG and SWOG, it shows really that, in fact, the door is quite open to test the concept of maximizing treatment in that disease setting. I also think that there are different trials that are being planned or are going to happen where they're looking at what I call a multi-targeted strategy. Remember, no one cancer is one molecular alteration, and so it's very critical that we lobby as physicians and as patients and as researchers that our trials need to be smarter clinical trials, not looking at one thing, one alteration, but rather look at a multi-targeted strategy because the ultimate goal is to kill the cancer cell. So I don't know, Tony, if that answers your question, but I feel very passionately about the subject.
So we have a couple of minutes left, and we may be able to get a couple of questions in from the wider audience, Dr. Hussain. So I'm going to hand this back over to Priya and see if we have a couple of those questions. Priya?
Thank you, Mike. Listeners, if you have a question for our expert, you can press 1 on your keypads, and we can bring you live on air to ask your question. We have a caller online. A person calling in from 7306613. Please ask your question. Listener calling in from 7306613. Please ask your question.
Hello?
Caller calling in from... Yes, you're alive. Please ask your question.
Yes, thank you. Hi, Dr. Hussain. This is Dominic Marisi. You mentioned the excitement around some of the improved imaging. As a patient that's been recurrent and has advanced disease, it always befuddles me why some of this technology, like some more advanced PET scans, aren't in more prevalent use. We seem to be stuck on, you know, using old bone scan, Tech 99 technology, and CT scans. Why do you think there's going to be faster adoption of PET scans and some of these more advanced tracers that are more meaningful for prostate cancer?
Thank you for the question, and actually it's an excellent question. In fact, this was one topic of discussion again at our consensus meeting recently. I think the biggest difficulty, sir, is the issue of trying to understand what that scan means. Remember, prostate cancer or any cancer can circulate into the blood, settle in organs, but may never ever show its face. So finding it very early in 100% of patients is fantastic. The question is, in which patient this particular seed is going to be relevant? And I think that is part of the difficulty we're all struggling with when it comes to the MRIs or the PET CTs and so on, is what does that uptake in a lymph node actually mean? Is it really going to be a relevant or irrelevant cancer? I do think ultimately the obligation is on the researchers and the medical community in terms of trying to define the what I would call the clinical utility of these tests, and then make a decision. Part of the comfort we have, and I'm going to count myself there, the comfort we have with regular CAT scan and bone scan is we actually understand what it means. And when I see a lesion, it's real. It's not a fake thing, or it's not something that's irrelevant. And I think that's part of the difficulty you're seeing. I do think that what we need to do as a, I suppose, country in so many ways, that our process for approving technology has to be tied into what is going to help us make decision, whether it's going to help us make a decision or not. And right now, the way we approve tests and imaging and so on, or even blood tests, it's based on a certain criteria. When it hits the clinic, the doctors are looking at it and say, I'm not really sure what I'm supposed to do with this. Does that kind of answer some of the questions you're addressing? I do think, however, that improved imaging is absolutely critical. The question is, it's not can you pick it up. It's can you pick it up, and do you know that this is actually a relevant finding?
Thank you, doctor. I've heard part of that discussion before, so at least my doctor is singing the same song.
Yep.
I understand. You have to understand what you're looking at and understand the relevancy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dominic. Caller using 910-667-2141, please ask your question. I guess we can actually look at some of the questions that have been submitted, Dr. Hussain. Maybe just a couple of them, because I think we are nearing the end of the show time. The first one would be, could you discuss any promising research and treatments being done for men who are diagnosed with Gleason 8-10 but with low PSA scores?
I think that from the perspective of treatment, I don't necessarily think the PSA by itself is the major driver. And certainly there are trials that are being planned to look at, certainly if it's radiation-type trials, at adding some of the most promising new hormonal agents into early in the course of the treatment, which is what I talked about, is to try to maximize the chance of cure. The other research we're seeing is to try to predict which Gleason 8-10 is going to result in a cancer spread versus not. And so some of the work is looking at what I call circulating biomarkers in the blood. I do think it's very, very intriguing, very interesting, but very early in the course of the disease.
Thank you, doctor. One last one. Recently, there has been info on using tetanus shots to spur the immune system in controlling brain cancer. Is there to try this on advanced prostate cancer patients with NETs?
I am not sure that this is going to happen right now in prostate cancer. I think we have other promising immune strategies, and I think that is, which we touched base on them earlier on, and I think that's probably going to be the focus for the next few years.
Dr. Hussain, thank you so very much for being with us today. It has been wonderful listening to you. Mike, Jan, Tony, and Rick, thanks a lot for the active participation. We have come to the end of our 1 hour, and the talk and its transcript will be made available on CureTalks website. Please visit curetalks.com for details on our upcoming talks. And searching for prostate cancer trials, please visit our award-winning tool Trilex at trilex.com. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hussain.
Yes.
Good night.
Thank you.